Good morning. Welcome to worship on this Lord's Day. As we come together like this, God invites us to lift our hearts up to Him, to lift them up to the God of our salvation. For our call to worship, I invite you to stand for a responsive reading from Psalm 118. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter.
I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation.
The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Join us in a responsive worship as we sing, I Will Enter His Gates.
So with the psalmist, we say, I rejoice with those who said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And we've come this morning, and the blessing of God falls upon his children, a blessing that welcomes us in gratefulness for coming to sing his praises, receive his blessing at this time. Grace to you once again, and peace in the name of God our Father, and Jesus Christ, our living King and Lord of all, and the power of the Spirit amongst us. Together, God's people do say, amen. And let's continue this song of thanksgiving together.
Songs of loudest praise.
seated.
When we come into God's presence, His holiness reveals our weakness and sin. God says to us in Proverbs 3, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight." Trust does not come easily for us, and leaning on our own understanding is all too common. In Jesus' name, we turn to God, seeking His forgiveness and grace once again. Please join me in prayer. Father, forgive us. Though you should guide us, we inform ourselves. Though you should be the one to rule us, we control ourselves. Though you should fulfill us, we console ourselves. For we think your truth is too high, your will too hard, your power too remote, your love too free. But they are not. Without them, we are of all people most miserable. Heal our confused mind with your word. Heal our divided will with your law. Heal our troubled conscience with your love. Heal our anxious hearts with your presence, all for the sake of your Son, who loved us and gave himself for us. Amen.
While it is true we have sinned, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. In this assurance, we commit ourselves to walk in obedience to Christ. God's will comes to us this morning in the words of Jesus from Matthew 5. Join me in a responsive reading of God's will for us. You are the salt of the earth.
But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot.
You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden.
Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house.
In the same way, let your light shine before others.
That they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven.
To let our light shine is to let Jesus' example be our own. As our commitment to walk in His way, join us as we sing, "Let It Be Said of Us."
This morning we are beginning and continuing our service in worship and listening to God's Word, and we're going to turn to Nehemiah 3. I invite you to open a Bible with me at this time as we're in a series in the book of Nehemiah, and as we just sang, let the cross be our glory, and let the Lord, all right, let Jesus be the song that people hear. And that is the theme of our service again this morning, and that's certainly the theme of our passage this morning as well. Bit of a run-up to our text this morning. We know that it's been a difficult season in the story of God's people. After so many years of disobedience to what God called them to, warnings from prophets to repent and come back, eventually God brought his judgment, allowed his judgment to come upon them, and they were taken into exile. And it looked dim for God's people, except, and this is a wonderful thing about the Christian life as well, God's promise, as we started the series, we heard God's promise always comes true. And he promised them that the season would only be a season. They would come back. And we come to our passage this morning and we find that that hope lives in the story of God's people. Now, technically, studies have been done on the books of the Bible, and it's believed that Ezra and Nehemiah were actually one book, but they were put into many translations as two books. But Ezra really was sent approximately 13 years prior to Nehemiah coming, and God sent him to help restore the worship life of the temple. The temple had been rebuilt, almost finished. Ezra was a part of that, but particularly in bringing the worship life of God's people back into the forefront of their new life back in Jerusalem. And now we're back to 445 BC. God has raised up Nehemiah, and he's filled with faith and filled with the Holy Spirit, and he just has so much zeal for God's promise that he knows the call of God in his life. He goes to the king, gets permission to come to Jerusalem. And then last Sunday in particular, we saw how through prayer and planning and preparation and then pursuit, right, those four P's of the last week, we talked about how God raised up Nehemiah to get the people on board, to hear the call of God to restore the city, particularly the walls of Jerusalem. We're going to touch on that quite a bit this morning. But I just want you to hold on to this thought for a minute, that the sheer monumental size of what Nehemiah was called to do, it's almost mind-boggling. The wall, I'll show you a map later, but the wall around the city of Jerusalem is somewhere between 2 to 2.5 miles long. This is no, well, I want to say this is no weekend activity, but as we'll see later in the series, they did do this work very quickly. But this was monumental, in part because of the sheer volume of wall they had to restore. But what I wanted to focus on this morning is the monumental impact of doing this work. What does it mean for God's people to rebuild the wall as a restoration of his promise, as a way of securing themselves in the promise that God had made? Clearly, walls are for security, and that was something that would come as a result of building them. But what would it mean for them to enter into the safeguarding of God's promise? And how does that impact their walk of faith? And that's what we're going to look at this morning as we wonder at what it means that God would work through us as living stones, as 1 Peter says, as living stones building the house of God. So we're going to open God's Word, but let's ask the Spirit to be present, invite that work to happen here in our hearts. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, even after an introduction like this, it is important for us to pause because we need your Holy Spirit to be present so that we not only hear your Word, but listen to it, and listen to it in a way that it moves into our hearts, and by the following of Jesus in the coming days, it'll be known that we take seriously the call of letting Jesus be the song of our life. So be present here in this place, Holy Spirit, and do that work in us so a new thing, maybe a brand new thing, can start in our hearts again today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to stand for the reading of God's Word, Nehemiah 3. And if it's a bit of a lengthier passage, and if you feel you want to sit down for that, that's fine. But here we are at Nehemiah 3, last at the end of chapter 2, Nehemiah called the people up and said, let's rebuild the wall. And they said, we're going to do it, and went right to work. And this is the story of how that happened. Let's listen to God's word. Eliashib, the high priest, and the fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. They dedicated it and set its doors in place, building as far as the Tower of the Hundred, which they dedicated as far as the Tower of Hananel. The men of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zakur, son of Imri, built next to them. The fish gate was rebuilt by the sons of Hasanah. They laid its beams and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Meremoth, son of Uriah, the son of Hakoz, repaired the next section. Next to him, Meshulam, son of Berechiah, the son of Meshebel, the son of Meshezebel, made repairs. And next to him, Zadok, son of Bana, also made repairs. The next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. The Jeshanah gate was repaired by Joada, son of Paseah, and Meshulam, son of Besodeiah. They laid its beams and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Next to them, repairs were made by the men from Gibeon and Mizpah, Melatiah of Gibeon and Jadon of Meronoth, places under the authority of the governor of Trans-Euphrates. Uzziel, son of Harahiah, one of the goldsmiths, repaired the next section. And Hananiah, one of the perfume makers, made repairs next to that. They restored Jerusalem as far as the broad wall. Rephaiah, son of Hur, ruler of the half-district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section. Adjoining this, Jediah, son of Harumaph, made repairs opposite his house. And Hattush, son of Hashabaniah, made repairs next to him. You see, we're making our way around the city, right? Malchiah, son of Harim, and Hashub, son of Pehath-Moab, repaired another section and the Tower of the Ovens. Shalom, son of Halohesh, ruler of a half-district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section with the help of his daughters. The Valley Gate was repaired by Hanun and the residents of Zanoa. They rebuilt it and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. They also repaired 500 yards of the wall as far as the Dung Gate. The Dung Gate was repaired by Micaiah, son of Rechab, ruler of the district of Beth Hakarem. He rebuilt it and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. The Fountain Gate was repaired by Shalun, son of Kol-Hose, ruler of the district of Mizpah. He rebuilt it, roofing it over and putting its doors and bolts and bars in place. He also repaired the wall of the Pool of Siloam by the king's garden as far as the steps going down from the city of David. Behind him, Nehemiah, son of Azbuk, ruler of the half-district of Beth-Zur, made repairs to the point opposite the tombs of David, as far as the artificial pool and the house of heroes. Next to him, the repairs were made by the Levites under Rehum, son of Bani. Beside him, Hashabiah, ruler of half the district of Keilah, carried out repairs for his district. Next to him, the repairs were made by their countrymen under Binui, son of Henadad, ruler of the other half-district of Keilah. Next to him, you get a system of what's happening here, right? Next to him, Azer, son of Jeshua, ruler of Mizpah, repaired another section from a point facing the ascent to the armory as far as the angle. Next to him, Baruch, son of Zabai, zealously repaired another section from the angle to the entrance of the house of Eliashib, the house priest. Next to him, Meremoth, son of Uriah, the son of Hakoz, repaired another section from the entrance of Eliashib's house to the end of it. The repairs next to him were made by the priests from the surrounding region. Beyond them, Benjamin and Hashub made repairs in front of their house, and next to him, Azariah, son of Messiah, the son of Ananiah, made repairs beside his house. next to them. Binui, son of Henadad, repaired another section from Azariah's house to the angle and the corner, and Palal, son of Uzai, worked opposite the angle and the tower, projecting from the upper palace near the court of the guard. Next to them, you're going to love all this Hebrew stuff, right? Next to them, Pedadiah, son of Parosh, and the temple servants living on the hill of Ophel made repairs up to the point opposite the water gate toward the east and the projecting tower. Next to them, the men of Tekoa repaired another section from the great projecting tower to the wall of Ophel. And above the horse gate, the priests made repairs, each in front of his own house. Next to them, Zadok, son of Immer, made repairs opposite his house. Next to him, Shemaiah, son of Shechaniah, the guard of the east gate, made repairs. Next to him, Hananiah, son of Shelemiah, and Hanun, the sixth son of Zaleph, repaired another section. Next to them, Meshulam, son of Berechiah, made repairs opposite his living quarters. Next to him, Malchijah, I think that's close enough, one of the goldsmiths, made repairs as far as the house of the temple servants and the merchants opposite the inspection gate, and as far as the room above the corner. And between the room above the corner and the sheep gate, the goldsmiths and merchants made repairs. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. You know what's a really cool thing is you go online and you search, you say NIV audio, and I listened to it 3 times this morning, plus the 4 times I did this week, and I thought I'd do a little better, but here we are. And let's just ask the obvious question, because it sort of makes us a little giddy listening to all of that. What does a list of names like this, I mean a catalog of names that are hard to pronounce, what do they have to teach us about faith? We believe, as followers of Jesus Christ, who take God's word very seriously, that every word of it is for our instruction, our teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. So what does this obscure, pronounced list of names, what does it teach us about faith? And I'm going to tell you. Because it turns out, in many ways, more than we might expect, and this isn't really the first point, but this is a way of introducing it. I want us to consider this morning how often God says in the Scripture, especially as you look at the book of Exodus or maybe Deuteronomy, even Isaiah, how many times God says to his people, I want and need you to remember. He tells them to remember. Remember what I have done, he says. Remember what you are because of what I have done, God says. Remember what it means to belong to me, God says. Remember, remember, remember. And then we get this list of names. And I would say that Nehemiah 3 functions as a remembering. These names are recorded 2,500 years later for us to remember something about who God is and something about how faith works and the faith that you and I are called to as we think about this theme in Nehemiah about rebuilding. So we're going to look at that this morning because it's historically true. These are real people in a real day at a real time doing real things. But more than that, it has some significance for us. And we're going to look at some principles this morning based on this passage, some principles that point us about how faith works. And the first one's going to be nobody drifts. Nobody drifts toward obedience. And then we're going to look next at how the Christian life is not lived in isolation. It's a beautiful picture of it here in Nehemiah 3, even with all those hard-to-pronounce names. It's this picture of community. And then the third principle we're going to look at is how Jesus expects us to give a wholehearted response to him. So let's look at those three principles about faith. The first one is this. Nehemiah reminds us that no one drifts toward obedience. Nobody drifts toward obedience. And Nehemiah 3 reminds us that, again, of this powerful principle. One person puts it like this. D.A. Carson writes, we do not gravitate toward godliness. We don't gravitate toward godliness. We drift toward compromise. We drift toward disobedience. We drift toward godliness, a godlessness. But we do not drift toward obedience. Now, you don't have to be a follower of Jesus long to know that's my story. That's our story. It takes some effort to follow Jesus. We did a series a little over a year ago on the book of Corinthians and how much there was pressure to compromise, and that's a constant in the Christian life. Another case in point, though, comes from our passage this morning, and a little bit of a timeline thing, but by the time Nehemiah arrives, it's been just over 90 years, almost 100 years since the first wave, and the estimates are that anywhere between 5 to 10,000, maybe even more, exiles. Cyrus is now king of Persia, and he releases them, and they go back to their homeland. And there's a significant number of people who return to the city. But notice what hasn't happened. The walls haven't been rebuilt. It's been almost 100 years, and I know we're not living in ancient Near Eastern times, but you don't even have to be a civil engineer to know that without the walls, you are very vulnerable. Now, there was some pressure to not rebuild the walls. I know that. And we know that when God raised up Ezra, it wasn't about the walls. It was about the temple. But I think it speaks very importantly to this very principle, and that is they lived for over 90 years, and clearly they lived in the city. You heard this list of people whose houses were right across from the wall. They lived in the city, but they did not rebuild the walls. Nobody drifts towards spiritual obedience. Nobody. There is a work the Holy Spirit has to do in us to bring us to that spot. Back in Nehemiah 1, Nehemiah hears from a kinsman, ask how things are in Jerusalem, and it's described as a people in great trouble and disgrace, and that's the disgrace. That's part of it. And Nehemiah's leadership, we find out, proves pivotal in reminding then, those days, that group, and today we hear as a church that we don't drift toward obedience. We don't. And let's look at the immensity of the project here. I said I was going to talk about this a bit this morning. It's worth talking about. This was going to require significant attention. Now, In part, I probably could have had this up on the screen as we read, because you see the red arrow at the start there? That's where the passage begins, and Nehemiah chapter 3 just goes section by section. There's 41 sections in the text, and he did this, and they did this, and there's 41 times. And so Nehemiah divides this massive black line we see, which is the walls around Jerusalem, which archaeologists believe was sort of the structure that was rebuilt. Distance. Somewhere between 2 to 2.5 miles of wall. Estimates are some of the wall was 40 feet tall, some shorter. Thickness of it, I'm not a civil engineer, so I'm not quite sure why that some estimate only 8 feet if it's 40 feet tall. I'm pretty sure my wall wouldn't stand if it was only 8 feet thick, but either way, massive, massive output of energy. What does this have to do with the principle of nobody drifts to spiritual obedience? Because a wall doesn't get built on its own. God said to his people, even before they went into exile, I will return you to your land to rebuild. And they hadn't done it. Not until God raised up Nehemiah would that happen. How were they going to take on this task? It wasn't going to happen overnight, and it wasn't going to happen by others. The principle here is nobody drifts toward spiritual obedience. Nobody. How did they do it? Section by section, brick by brick, step by step. In fact, the word section here is used 10 times in our passage, but you hear it every single time, and next to him, and next to him, and next to him. This was a call, as God has always done for his people, to say, all right, obey me now. I have saved you by grace. Follow me. These are the words of Jesus. How did Nehemiah do it? Well, based on this passage, we can say that we heard this last week where he planned the project and prepared for it. He walked around the wall and he divided it up in 41 spaces. Amazing skills by one man, no doubt about it. But manageable and workable and therefore doable. But all of it, that principle we're hearing this morning, which is nobody drifts toward this. If you want a bigger prayer life, a stronger time in God's word, there's work to be done. If you want to be more faithful at work, more faithful at school, if your desire is to take your faith in Jesus and let your light shine, as we heard about in our service this morning, there's work to be done. You will not drift toward it. The call to follow Jesus is a call to action. And here in our passage this morning, this wonderful principle about faith, we need a plan and we need to follow the plan. Steps that need to be taken against the inevitable drift. We sang in our service, started out one of the opening songs, we sang the words, "Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love." That's the drift that we have to counter daily, actively. Or, to use a spiritual metaphor, the walls will never be rebuilt, ever. Nehemiah 3 just simply says to us this morning, because of the call of Jesus, what's your plan? What's your plan to follow Jesus? What is it going to look like to grow in your trust of Christ? Whether it's in your prayer time or God's word. I mean, I can't tell you how many times as a pastor I'll say to somebody, "How's your prayer life?" And all of them to a T, and I get it because I'm there. "Well, it's not what it should be." "Yeah, I know. But what's your plan to get it better? How are you going to engage clearly the vision God has for you in Jesus?" As the wall metaphor is here before us, to build up that in your life. You will not drift toward it. It doesn't happen. It leaks away from you, if anything. So there's a challenge from God's word. Nehemiah 3, a very interesting passage where I almost made it through pronouncing every name the way I thought I was going to. But here's this vision for you and me as we follow Jesus. If I'm not going to drift toward him, how am I going to make it active to follow him? Let's look at the second one. Here's the second principle. We need a community to do it. We need a community to get her done. There is strength in solidarity, or to use a popular phrase in our day, teamwork makes the dream work. Hey, teamwork makes the dream work. If you're thinking about where you can grow in your faith in Jesus Christ, your best asset might be sitting right next to you. It might be in this room. It might be through CBS or BSF or some Bible study program somewhere that they're just going to challenge an iron sharpening iron moment, and that's what happens here. There is a whole lot of wall to build, and there were a lot of gates to set. Funny names, some of them, by the way. Dung Gate. Dung Gate was on the very southern point. It was what led to what is the garbage heap, right? The pile of garbage and refuse from the city, but you know, they call them that. They had the Sheep Gate and the Water Gate. And by the way, don't put too much spiritual significance in the name of these walls. I don't think that's important. They're just named what they are, maybe for very practical reasons. It tells us in this passage, and I'll get to this back again in a moment, that when the men of Tekoa, were called up to build, what does it say there? It says that some among them, their noble people, refused to build. They refused to be a part of that community. And for 2,500 years, they're remembered for that. Make sure that's not our story. But as for the rest, right, this principle stands very true. There's strength and solidarity. Who do we find rebuilding it? Well, there's priests and there's perfume makers. There's goldsmiths and Shallum's daughters. There are rulers and Levites, temple servants and merchants. To use the language of Paul in 1 Corinthians 12, there's the body and there's a whole lot of parts to it. And they're all on mission together. It takes a community. Living for Jesus, a life that is true. And we're going to sing those words at the end of the message this morning. It expects much of us. But here's the wonderful thing about it. By God's design, he has given you the person sitting around you. He's given us each other. Because not unlike the wall rebuild plan, the call to follow Jesus is monumental. In some respects, let's be honest, in every respect, Jesus says it's going to cost us. That's why he tells us to count it. Count it first. It will be costly, but it's not something that is a solo mission. And so we find in our passage this morning that just as every part of the wall was assigned to a specific group, the Christian life is a group project too. Every person doing their part. I came across this quote from a friend of mine this past week. He said, the founder of Forbes magazine once said, "How do you spell success? T-E-A-M-W-O-R-K. Teamwork. That's how you spell success." I know we struggle sometimes in our spiritual walk with Jesus. But maybe we should consider far more than we do, that maybe the way to strengthen it isn't to keep going solo. maybe the way to grow our walk in Christ so he is seen in us and we are more faithful in him. Or as we read from Matthew 5, we're not like a light that's covered. It's set out. Maybe the strength of it is other people working with, alongside, beside us. And that's what Nehemiah 3 speaks to. It says it to the church. We need each other so that we don't fail at the first principle, which is drift. And we see this in our church, not this church, well, in churches, whether North America or in the world, we see so much spiritual drift happening, so much drifting from biblical truth. One of the things I'm really excited about, it makes many things, but in our own denomination in the last few years, there's been a reconviction about biblical truth when it comes to things like human sexuality. This is group thinking, group project work. I'm grateful for that. And here we see together, they're working together, they're building together, they're cooperating together because, as we would say in the New Testament, they're united in Christ together, and it's wonderful. Every member doing its part. Which means, it's not bad to ask this self-reflective question, what am I doing to encourage the people around me in their faith? How am I investing, whether it's an opportunity for a Bible study group or be praying for or coming alongside and think of maybe you're a senior saint and there's a new believer. How can we invest in that? Invest in them so they see the glory of the gospel and the wonder of the Father and how great Jesus is and we can build each other up. There's strength in solidarity. Teamwork does make the dream work. How are we going to put our shoulders to the work at hand? How can we do that? The building up of the church of Jesus Christ for the glory of the Father. So far this morning, we've just looked at two principles. I'm going to get to the third, right? But the first one is nobody drifts towards spiritual obedience. And second, God's given us a church to help us in that, to help us grow, to help us be stronger. Now let's look at the third principle this morning. And the third principle is this, that Jesus expects a wholehearted response. There's two moments in this passage which just screamed out at me as I was reading it again this week. The first one is the men of Tekoa who sat on their hands because they refused to be supervised. They would not put their shoulders to the work. For 2,500 years, that's their testimony. And then there's Baruch, son of Zabal. And what does it say about him? He zealously, not half-heartedly, he zealously repaired another section. And for 2,500 years, that's his testimony. Which one would you like to have? As you think about being a parent of kids or a grandparent to kids or somebody who's just living in a community and you're the light in that workplace or whatever it is, what will be the testimony? Will you have that wholehearted response of Baruch? Or will Tekoa, the men of Tekoa, shape us? It's a sad testimony, really, of theirs. Let it not be said of us. Or as we sang this morning, what should be said of us, that we're quick about forgiveness and eager to love. Let that be said of us. I mean, what a contrast, really. You just can't ignore it. It's the zeal of Nehemiah. It's the zeal of Baruch. It's the steadfast heart, zealous, which is what we heard about already in this series about Nehemiah. He was just zealous for God and allowed that to shape his world and define his steps and his walk with Jesus. I don't know about this Baruch. It doesn't say much more than this. What does that zealous look like? Maybe he worked extra fast. Maybe he worked extra hours. Maybe he just had a positive mental attitude on the job site. I don't know. But I do believe it was because of his love for God. And whatever it was, I'm reminded of these words in Colossians 3, verse 23 and 24. Paul is writing to the church, and they're wondering about their identity in this huge Roman world where they feel so infinitesimally small. And he says this in Colossians 3, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord. That's zealous. Not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. And so the reflection comes. What's the steadfastness of my heart? Am I wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for Jesus? Because the way we serve Jesus matters. He expects this wholehearted response. One day, he'll be before us. We'll stand before Christ, and he's going to ask us to give an account. And this is the parable of the talents. And he's given us these things, and at the end he's going to say, so what did you do with what I gave you? He's going to ask that question. He's not going to look for an answer about how much money we made or how much success we had or where we had our names etched into the stones of history. He'll ask what we've done for him. The call is for a steadfast heart. The call is wholehearted. Now, when we started out this passage this morning, I asked you the simple question, what does this list, all right, this catalog of hard-to-pronounce names have to teach us about walking in faith? And I don't know where God's going to take you this week, but you're going to say, you know, I heard this crazy sermon on Sunday of names, and I learned something about what it means to follow Jesus. Because God tells me I need to remember. I have to remember what he's done. I need to remember what those who've gone before me have done and who are called into the account and the testimony of the faithful. Listen to these words from Philippians 1, verse 27 to 28. Whatever happens, Paul again, writing to the church, another church, this one's in Philippi instead of Colossae, but he's writing to the church in Philippi. He says, whatever happens, and that really is true. Anything could happen. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Then, he says, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm, so they didn't drift, in one spirit, striving together. That's the second principle, right? Striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened. In other words, they were steadfast. Without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. When I came across this passage, I thought, there's a great summary of Nehemiah 3, and one I'd hope we cling to, that we would be called those who stand firm in one spirit, that we are striving together as one for the faith, and that we are not frightened. And therefore, we're steadfast. What a wonderful description of Nehemiah 3. Again, those three principles, standing firm, striving together, not being frightened, or Nehemiah 3, not drifting, doing life together, and staying steadfast, whatever happens. We're not building a wall around a city. Jesus is the new Jerusalem, and we are the new people, Israel of God. But 1 Peter tells us that we are living stones which God is building, putting together to build his church. That's us now. So whatever happens, and the task is monumental, and Christ is with us to the very end, help us, oh Jesus, help us, Holy Spirit, to conduct ourselves in a manner that is worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Nehemiah's day, it was faith engaged, so it wasn't drifting. It was in community with a sense of urgency, and therefore, I would say, very wholehearted. And now, people of God, as you've come this morning to listen to God's word, to come with his people, to worship, be refreshed, it is now our job to go. And if we are in Christ, and here's the basics of the gospel again, it's just good to hear it. Faith is the access. Faith is the access to the treasure of infinite worth in Christ. All you need to do is receive it by faith. But if you are in Christ, then let's do this. Let's live for him, a life that is true, striving to please him in all that we do, yielding allegiance, glad-hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessing for me. I grew up in the Christian Reformed Church as a kid, and I remember being a part of the cadet program, which is a program for young boys to grow in their faith of Jesus, and this was the theme song we'd sing every Monday night. Living for Jesus, a life that is true. That's got to be the heartbeat of what we are. By God's grace, I pray that'll become the story that we're going to live again in the coming days. which is merely an echo of what we profess in Lord's Day 1, question answer 1, the third paragraph. Because I belong to him, Christ by his Holy Spirit assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. As we make our way through Nehemiah, we're just in the third chapter. Nehemiah's journey, we're going to find out what the people had its ups. This is clearly one of them. But it also had its downs. And so often that is true of the Christian life. One day, 2,500 years ago, God's people took hold of a vision, his vision for them, in a specific place but for a great purpose. Almost 500 years after this moment, Jesus came to the world to do the Father's will. And rooted in him, Jesus now says to us who follow him, let's do that. Let's follow. You're not going to drift into it. You need the group you see around you for it. And let's be ready from now on, steadfastly pursuing it. Because this, in a world of so much that is less than exciting at times, this is the brilliance of the church at its best. Let's pray together. God in heaven, you place a call before us. And I pray that through your Holy Spirit, that convicting work would begin also in my own heart. How am I drifting too much? Where have I ignored the strength of the people around me? And if my heart's not steadfast, oh God, correct that too. But do this amongst us so that the city of Kalamazoo and the world around us would see that here is a group that knows that we are living stones in the hands of Jesus. And that calls us to a life that is true, striving to please him in all that we do. Holy Spirit, do this work in us again. And for those who've maybe yet not seen the joy and benefit of it, renew our hearts to the Holy Spirit to see the wonders of the gospel. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. And so we sing a song that, well, how many of you were in cadets? How many of you here? There's a few hands in here. Yeah. Great ministry program, right? But here we are, and we're going to do it as God's people. Let's stand as we sing, Living for Jesus, a Life That Is True.
Master.
one of the fruits of a life that is faithful to Jesus is it's not just something we wish we did more. We actually do. We pray. And we do so corporately as a way of encouraging us our own spiritual walk with Christ to grow in our prayer life. And so we spend some time in prayer. And a couple prayer requests to remember again this morning is the family of Nick Niebuhr. The funeral took place on Friday, but we trust to God's benevolent and wonderful care the life of his son, Nick, and pray for comfort for all of the family. Let's continue also to remember in prayer Joyce Jeltema. She is in hospice care and for strength in these days as she finishes her earthly journey. This past week, Marilyn Stremler was admitted to Bronson Hospital for an evening for some observation dealing with some breathing issues. She's back again at the rehab center at Friendship Village. Let's pray for her in daily strength. And then continuing to pray for Sherry Gavin's daughter, Jenny, and her battle with alcohol addiction. Pray that God would give her a new heart and a new life in the midst of this season. Let's do this. Let's pray to God together. Loving God, we who seek to live a life that is true for Jesus, we turn our hearts to you again this morning, you who are our first love and our best love, and it's a love that never fails, a love that is new every morning. And we know that because we've seen how great your love is toward us. And in the words of 1 John 4, how great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called his children. And that is what we are. Lord, may your praise be first on our lips and strong in our hearts as we look to the week ahead. We lament, O God, that we do live in a world that witnesses events that dishonor your name, as well as the names of those who are our neighbor. And so we cry out to you, O God, for mercy. We pray for one another again this morning. We pray for those who are sitting next to us, for our neighbors throughout the world. We pray for healing in the places of our brokenness. We pray for comfort for those who mourn. Lord, we pray for friends and family members who are facing health issues or maybe relationship challenges or financial struggles. And Lord, we ask that you would lift the weight of their worries and call them to find peace in you. Father, we pray for our city. We are grateful that you have placed us here. And there's so much need, and you have put the church on mission to be a people who live under the goodness of your sovereign care. May we find again in the days to come the joy of giving ourselves away, the joy of serving each other in Jesus' name. We pray for our missionaries, for those who are tirelessly committing themselves, sharing the good news of Jesus where they are, showing God's redeeming and transforming grace. And as they serve in your name in faraway places, or maybe even very close to home, Lord, grant them courage and conviction to find joy in the gospel of Christ. We pray for one another. We thank you for our church family here at Heritage. We pray for those who need your healing and strength in each day. We entrust them to you. And Lord, we pray for the days to come. Strengthen our faith that we may live unashamed. We pray for those who do not believe in you, Jesus, for loved ones or neighbors, a coworker, a fellow student, those who are far off or sitting next to us here in church. Open their eyes to the hope that will never disappoint. In the days to come, may the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart be pleasing to you, O God. Help us to seek first your kingdom and righteousness as Jesus calls us to. May we trust in your strength and put our hope in you for every tomorrow. In Jesus' name, amen. A couple of announcements as we come to the close of our service this morning. Again, be sure to check out our Heritage Happenings. Just an update, we are hoping or expecting that later this week they will begin the project on our roof. And that'll be a 3 to 4 week project of stripping everything off and putting a new metal roof up on. Our council is meeting on Tuesday to look at some plans for the new addition the school is proposing, and we should be able to present something to all of you very soon as well. Our next mobile food initiative is this Saturday, and come and join us, and we express the love of Jesus to those in need in our community. If you're interested in serving, just come on out a 7:45 in the morning. Usually the truck arrives a little earlier than that, set up, and we'll distribute the food to our neighbors. A quick reminder that on Sunday, October 6th, is the next potluck. So Sunday, October 6th, is the next potluck. That'll follow the morning worship service. And bring a hot dish or a salad or a sweet treat, whatever you're able to bring, and we'll enjoy a nice meal together. Speaking of meals, this past Thursday was the International Student Luncheon, and thank you to Jan Ellens for taking some pictures. And what you see here is part of the event. All the food is on the tables being served, and with some of our volunteers who helped out with that. The picture here on the right, the two individuals, the fellow individual, that's Kevin Edlifson. He's one of the chaplains on campus, and then Laura Osborne. They're the ones that we support. And I will say, I'm a terrible memory usually, but I will say that this was some of the most food that we've brought in quite a few years. So thank you. Thank you for your support of this ministry and to our volunteers for helping out on Thursday morning. Finally, we have an opportunity to bring our gifts to God. The offering is received as we exit the sanctuary, but our tithes support the ministry of this church. Our offering this morning is a way of equipping our deacons in their work of providing benevolent or mercy care to those in our community and outside of this church community, to those living in our neighborhoods. And I encourage you to generously support the work of our deacons, and all loose change cash offerings will go toward the benevolent fund. Invite you to stand as we now come to the close of what has been a truly wonderful time of worship in which God has invited us to be here. And we've heard some important things and principles about what it means to stand confidently and unashamed in Jesus Christ this morning. And it is important that we hear that. Let's not think we can drift toward obedience. Let's not think we can do this on our own. We need a community. And let's let our hearts be steadfast, wholeheartedly willing and ready to follow Jesus. And know that God is going with us. And he goes before us. And one of the ways we mark that in our worship is through a benediction, or a blessing that comes from Scripture. And this blessing comes this morning from Romans 15, verses 5 and 6. May the God who gives you endurance and encouragement give you a spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Jesus Christ, so that you, with one heart and one mouth, may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And together, God's people say, Amen.